Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum, students. Today the topic of discussion is metabolic acidosis and respiratory acidosis. So let us know the learning objectives first. At the end of this lecture, you will be able to know the definition, the causes, the manifestation, the compensatory mechanism, and the treatment of metabolic acidosis, along with the same, the definition, causes, manifestation, compensatory mechanism, and the treatment of respiratory acidosis. So moving on, before coming up to the main topic of discussion, let me just review things about acidosis and alkalosis. As you have already studied and discussed that there are two abnormalities in the acid-base balance. One is acidosis and the other is alkalosis. So acidosis, as the name indicates, means excess acids. That means it is going to result into decreased pH. That is, which is normal, is about 7.35 to 7.45. So if it's less than 7.35, that means it's going to be decreased pH and will be acidosis. It can either be a metabolic or either a respiratory. While in case of alkalosis, because of excess alkalis, the pH increases, that is more than 7.45, and hence the pH increases. And alkalosis can also be either respiratory or metabolic. So talking about my topics, you're going to talk about metabolic acidosis and respiratory acidosis. So let's discuss here. As you all know that acidosis means the pH is going to be low, while for metabolic means the cause should be in the metabolic thing. So it's going to be bicarbonate ion, which is low, and hence because of it the acidosis will occur. And you have to remember, every time when we talk about any of the disorder, if it's metabolic, the compensation for that will be the opposite. That means the compensation for metabolic will be respiratory, and hence you can see here that compensation is respiratory, as the primary cause is decreased bicarbonate ion, which is causing acidosis, while to compensate it, the respiratory system is compensating it by decreasing the carbon dioxide. That means decreasing carbon dioxide is going to remove excess of carbonic acid, and hence that will bring the pH back to normal. All right, and in case of respiratory acidosis, as the cause is respiratory, so that means the carbon dioxide is the main thing. So that should be increased, because carbon dioxide, again, carbonic acids are going to be more, and hence the pH is going to decrease. But to compensate this disorder, we are going to have a compensation in the metabolic system. So the opposite for respiratory is metabolic, and hence, as it is acidosis, we need more alkali to compensate it. So that means more increased bicarbonate will compensate for respiratory acidosis. Okay, now coming up to the main topic. So first of all, we're going to talk about metabolic acidosis. Again, metabolic and acidosis. So acidosis means decreased pH, that is less than 7.35, and metabolic as means so it's going to be with the bicarbonate ion. All right, so decreased plasma bicarbonate ion, which is about less than 22 milliequivalent per liter. All right, and this concentration is due to either a gain in hydrogen ion or due to loss in bicarbonate ion. Now, as I already told you, that the body compensates for the decrease in pH by the opposite mechanism, by the respiratory mechanism, by increasing the respiratory rate. All right, so by increasing the respiratory rate, we're going to remove excess of carbon dioxide, and in turn what will happen, the carbonic acid levels will decrease, and hence as the acid levels are decreasing, so the pH will be coming towards the normal. So this is how metabolic acidosis is defined. Okay, now coming up to the causes and the manifestations. So the etiology of the metabolic acidosis. So first of all, we need to know that the main etiology includes, firstly, excess metabolic acids. It can be either an excess in metabolic acids. It can either be due to excessive bicarbonate loss. All right, so that can also cause a decrease in the pH, while the third one can be increased chloride levels. All right. So now we're going to discuss these three separately. First of all, excess metabolic acids and what are the causes that actually cause excess metabolic acids in the human body. So excess production of metabolic acids can be due to lactic acidosis. Now lactic acidosis, as you have already heard, that when we do a lot of exercise, or because of that exercise, what happens is that there is normally your body gets the ATP by aerobic metabolism, but in case of exercise which is really strenuous, and the the normal mechanism of ATP production is not enough to provide the energy, what happens is an anaerobic pathway moves on, which is the anaerobic metabolism of the glucose to provide the ATP. So in that case, what happens is lactic acid is formed. So lactic acidosis, this can be one cause. Then diabetic ketoacidosis, this happens in the patients with diabetes mellitus. What happens is, again, they produce keto acids in response to their anaerobic metabolism of the glucose, and this can also cause excess metabolic acids. All right, then alcoholic ketoacidosis, again due to excess alcohol use, ketoacidosis can happen. There is excess keto acids production in the liver. Then fasting and starvation can also cause increased acids. Then we have poisoning. It can be due to all these medications. Isoniazid, which is used in the treatment of TB, salicylate, which is aspirin, methanol, pyrrolidehyde, ethylene glycol. So these medication poisoning can also have an excess metabolic acid. Then impaired elimination of metabolic acids. Now this can either be due to kidney failure or dysfunction, because normally to balance the acid-base balance, what happens is your kidney has the ability to remove hydrogen ions and to absorb the bicarbonate ions. But if there is a kidney failure, this normal mechanism is also not working. So what happens is there is more hydrogen ion retention and more of the bicarbonate ion loss. So in that case also metabolic acidosis can happen. And then uremic acidosis can also be one caused due to, again, severe renal failure. So now the second one was excessive bicarbonate loss. Okay, you can see that there are some things written here, increased anion gap or normal anion gap and normal anion gap. So I'll talk about the anion gap in the next slide. But right now we're just discussing about the causes. The second cause was excessive bicarbonate loss, and this can happen in loss of intestinal secretions. This is one source, most important source of loss of bicarbonate ions, either by severe diarrhea or intestinal suctioning or intestinal or biliary fistula can also result in excessive bicarbonate loss. Then increased renal losses. Because I told you that normally the normal mechanism is that the kidney is going to absorb the bicarbonate ions, but in case of these diseases, what happens is there are increased losses of bicarbonate ion, and hence it will in turn ultimately result into acidosis. The renal tubular acidosis, the treatment with carbonic anhydrase inhibitors or hypoaldosteronism. So this was the second cause. And the third cause is increased chloride levels. So this is termed as hyperchloremic acidosis, and again the anion gap remains normal in this. So this can be either due to excessive reabsorption of the chloride by the kidney, okay, that can cause increased chloride ions. Then the sodium chloride infusions, again this can result into increased chloride levels, or treatment with ammonium chloride or the parenteral hyperalimentation. This is also given to patients who need parenteral nutrition, which is composed of amino acids along with chloride. So in that case also, it can result in increased chloride levels or hyperchloremic acidosis. So these were some of the causes. Now we're going to talk about the manifestations or the signs and symptoms. So again, first of all, the blood levels. The blood pH will be decreased as it is acidosis, and the bicarbonate ion, because it is metabolic, so the main primary thing is that bicarbonate ion will be decreased. And while the compensation should be opposite, that means it should be respiratory. So in that case, what happens is the excess ventilation will remove excess carbon dioxide, and hence the carbon dioxide will be decreased as a compensatory mechanism. Now, talking about the signs and symptoms, we are going to divide these signs and symptoms into three categories. First of all, those signs and symptoms that are due to the cause of the metabolic acidosis or any disease that is causing this acidosis. It can either be a diabetic ketoacidosis. In case of diabetic ketoacidosis, there will be more glucose levels in the plasma along with the urine, and let's say in case of alcoholic ketoacidosis, there will be more alcohol levels in the plasma. While if we have poisonings, of course there will be more levels of those drugs in the poison in your blood plasma. And in case of kidney failures, the renal function tests will be deranged. So those signs and symptoms will be appearing because of the main cause that is causing metabolic acidosis. That was one. The second is that the signs and symptoms that are appearing because of metabolic acidosis itself. After that, and the last one is that signs and symptoms or those manifestations that are appearing because of the compensation. So this is one. Okay, so I told you three. First one, which was because of the cause, the disease that is causing metabolic acidosis. Second one, ultimately metabolic acidosis is resulting into the signs and symptoms. And the third one is the signs and symptoms of the compensatory mechanisms. So the second one, as we can discuss, for the metabolic acidosis that causes signs and symptoms, it can be divided into gastrointestinal functions, neural functions, and cardiovascular functions, or skin or skeletal system functions. So in case of gastrointestinal functions, there is going to be anorexia, nausea and vomiting, abdominal pain. For neural functions, they can be weakness, lethargy, general malaise, confusion, stupor, coma, or depression of the vital functions. And in case of cardiovascular functions, there's going to be peripheral vasodilation. So as you can see here, peripheral vasodilation is going to increase the circulation in the peripheries, and hence the skin will be more warm and flushed. So that can also be a skin manifestation, warm and flushed. Apart from that, cardiovascular abnormalities can have decreased heart rate. The heart rate can decrease along with the BP that can fall, and cardiac arrhythmias can also happen. And for skeletal system, the bone disease can happen, which again is due to renal failure, and hence that can cause bone diseases as well. Okay, now the signs of compensation. So I told you that for metabolic acidosis, the compensatory mechanism is that there is going to be excess removal of carbon dioxide by hyperventilation. So in that case, there is a typical breathing pattern which occurs in metabolic acidosis compensation, which is termed as Kosmol's breathing. You need to remember Kosmol's breathing. As you can see here, Kosmol's respiration. And what is that actually? It is the increased rate and depth of respiration, which in turn is going to excrete excess of the carbon dioxide to in turn compensate for the acidosis. And then there can be hyperkalemia. That is another sign and symptom of compensation. In how is hyperkalemia occurring? Now this is the kidney compensation. The kidneys are going to secrete more of the hydrogen ions to normalize the pH, and in turn of those removal of the hydrogen ions, they're going to absorb more potassium, and hence that is going to cause hyperkalemia. Now, because the kidneys are secreting more hydrogen ions, so there is going to be acid urine, and then increased ammonia in urine as well. So these are the manifestations or signs and symptoms of metabolic acidosis. Now I talked about anion gap. So anion gap what it is actually. Anine gap is a diagnostic concept which describes, now this is the formula for the anine gap, the difference between the plasma concentration of the measured cation and the sum of the measured anions, that is chloride and bicarbonate. All right. So in case of formula, how are we going to write it? Anion gap is equals to the difference between the plasma concentration of the major measured cation, which is sodium, and the sum of the chloride, the sum of measured anions. Anions are the negatively charged ions. So the chloride ion plus the bicarbonate ion. This is the sum of the anions, and the difference is going to be from the measured cation. So normal anion gap is about 8 to 16 milliequivalent per liter, and as expressed in words, again you can see that anion gap is sodium minus chloride plus bicarbonate. Now this difference, the anion gap, actually represents the concentration of the unmeasured anions such as the phosphates, sulfates, organic acids and proteins. Okay, and why is this important to discuss in metabolic acidosis? Because this is going to be helping us in diagnosing causes of the metabolic acidosis. We can diagnose the cause of metabolic acidosis by using this anine gap, because I told you previously here that these are the three causes. So as you can see here, that in these causes the anine gap is going to be increased, while in both of these causes the anine gap is going to be normal. So in that sense we can differentiate between them and we can diagnose. Now you're going to look at this the chart which is given here, which shows the anine gap in two of the causes. The anion gap in acidosis, which is due to excess organic acids, which was our first cause, excess metabolic acids, and acidosis, which is due to excess chloride levels. So the third one, which I told you, was hyperchloremic acidosis. Now to differentiate between the two, what happens is that this is a normal thing that's occurring. The normal anion gap is 12. And here you can see that the anion gap is increased, which is around 25. Now what happens is, in acidosis due to excess organic acids, what happens is that in this equation, this bicarbonate ion is actually replaced by the sodium content of those organic acids which are excessively present in the body. And those sodium that sodium content is actually going to replace this bicarbonate ions, and hence it's going to increase the anion gap. All right. So in that case, what happens is, in this case, the anion gap is increasing. But in case of hyperchloremic acidosis, the anion gap is going to remain normal. There's going to be no change in the anion gap. And as you can see here, that the anion gap in acidosis due to excess metabolic acids and excess plasma chloride levels. So the unmeasured anions such as phosphates, sulfates and organic acids increase the anion gap because they replace the bicarbonate. This assumes that there is no change in the sodium content. Okay, so working on with the anion gap for the diagnosis of metabolic acidosis, we can categorize them into three categories. Those conditions that have decreased anion gap, those conditions that have increased anion gap, and those conditions that have normal anion gap. So conditions that have decreased anion gap less than 8 milliequivalent per liter are going to be hypoalbuminemia, multiple myelomas, increased unmeasured cations, that happens in hyperkalemia, hypercalcemia, hypermagnesemia, lithium intoxication. And then those conditions that are going to have increased anion gaps, that is more than 16 milliequivalent per liter, we can have the conditions like diabetic ketoacidosis, alcoholic ketoacidosis, lactic acidosis, starvation, renal insufficiency, and presence of drug or chemical anions like salicylate, all these poisonings. So the better way to remember these conditions that have increased anion gap, you can remember this mnemonic, which is mud piles, and it means M for methanol, U for uremia, D for diabetic ketoacidosis or alcoholic ketoacidosis, P for pyrrolidehyde, and I for iron or isoniazid, which is another toxication. And then we have L for lactic acidosis, E for ethylene glycol or methanol, and S for salicylates. So mud piles is going to be a mnemonic used for the causes of anion gap, which have increased anion gap, conditions which have increased anion gap. And normal anion gap occurs in loss of bicarbonates, diarrhea, pancreatic fluid loss, ileostomy, and chloride retention. As I previously I told you, these conditions are going to have normal anion gap. Okay, so the treatment of metabolic acidosis. First of all, again, we have to identify the cause of the metabolic acidosis, and then ultimately we are going to correct that cause, and we are going to correct the condition that caused the disorder and restore the fluids and the electrolytes that have been lost from the body. Now, for example, if there is lactic acidosis, the treatment normally happens to be to improve the tissue perfusion, because normally lactic acidosis happens in conditions like cardiac arrest or maybe due to some strenuous exercise. And these conditions actually, what do? They are actually decreasing the blood supply. So to increase the perfusion, we have to correct it by improving the tissue perfusion. And then in case of sepsis related acidosis, the treatment option is going to be treating the infection. And then if there's a kidney disease, hemodialysis can be considered. Now the use of supplemental sodium bicarbonate is the main stay of treatment for some forms of normal anion gap acidosis. Sodium bicarbonate is only administered in case of normal anion gap acidosis, not in case of increased anion gap acidosis. Okay, so now talking about the second topic, which is respiratory acidosis. Now again, acidosis means decreased pH, which should be less than 7.35. And as this is respiratory, so the primary cause here should be respiratory. And respiratory means it should be with carbon dioxide. So excess carbon dioxide is going to lead to respiratory acidosis. And excess carbon dioxide means normally if it is from 35 to 45 mmHg, it is going to be increased. That means more than 45 mmHg. And why is carbon dioxide increasing in the body? So this is occurring because of the conditions that are adding to impaired ventilation. So the respiratory conditions that are impairing the alveolar ventilation are going to cause an increase in plasma carbon dioxide levels. That is also known as hypercapnia, and along with a decrease in the pH leading to respiratory acidosis. So as it is respiratory, so the compensatory mechanism is going to be metabolic, which is increasing the conservation and generation of bicarbonate ion to bring the pH level to normal, or the kidney compensation can be by elimination of the hydrogen ions. Now we have two of the respiratory failures, because I told you that normally respiratory acidosis is due to excess carbon dioxide, which is because of the impaired alveolar ventilation. So impaired alveolar ventilation can be an acute type or can be a chronic type. So acute respiratory failure is associated with a rapid rise in arterial carbon dioxide with a minimal, very less increase in plasma bicarbonate level, and this is a compensatory mechanism. So what happens is there is a large decrease in pH because of increased rise in carbon dioxide. While in chronic respiratory acidosis, there is sustained increase in carbon dioxide level. So this is slowly increasing, while the resulting renal adaptation with a more marked increase in bicarbonate levels. So what happens is in this case, the bicarbonates are more markedly increased as a compensation, and hence there's a lesser decrease in pH. Now the causes and manifestations of respiratory acidosis. Now for the causes, again, because of I told you impaired ventilation, which can either be due to an acute cause or due to a chronic cause. So acute causes includes depression of respiratory center, which can either be due to a head injury or maybe a drug overdose, and there can be conditions like airway obstruction or disorders of the chest wall and respiratory muscles. This can be one cause of the acute respiratory failure, like paralysis of the respiratory muscles due to chest injuries. Kyphoscoliosis is a skeletal abnormality of the chest, which hence patients will not be able to respirate properly, and treatment with paralytic drugs. Then the chronic and lung diseases, like some of the lung diseases like respiratory distress syndrome can or pneumonia can also be taken as acute causes. But for chronic respiratory failures, there are diseases like COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, or diseases like which includes emphysema, chronic bronchitis, and some others, while the others are included in respiratory acute respiratory failures. So mainly we are going to describe them as depression of the respiratory center, the lung diseases, which is in turn going to impair ventilation, then airway obstruction, and breathing air with high carbon dioxide content. The manifestations include decreased in pH, again then carbon dioxide, which is the primary thing. Carbon dioxide is increasing the carbonic acid levels in brain, causing respiratory acidosis, and compensation is going to be increased by carbonate levels, which is either by the kidneys. Okay, now the normally, because there is increased acids, so what happens is mainly this happens in your brain, because it is able to cross the carbon dioxide is able to cross the blood brain barrier, and hence it's the increased levels of carbon dioxide in the brain can cause some of the signs and symptoms. For example, dilatation of cerebral vessels and depression of the neural functions, headache, weakness, behavioral changes like confusion, depression, paranoias, hallucinations, tremors, paralysis, stupor, and coma. And skin again can be either skin can be warm or flushed. And then the signs of compensation. So the signs of compensation are acidic urine, because of course the compensation is occurring in which the kidneys are going to excrete the hydrogen ions. So there is going to be acidic urine. Okay. So now that moving on towards the treatment, again the same treatment options, we are going to first of all identify, and then we are going to treat the cause, whatever the respiratory cause is, where that is impairing the ventilation. We are going to identify it and we are going to treat the cause. And then the treatment of the acute and chronic respiratory acidosis is directed towards improving the ventilation, because of course the main cause for respiratory acidosis was there was impaired ventilation, which in turn was increasing the carbon dioxide levels in your body, and hence what all the signs and symptoms that were occurring or all the abnormalities was because of the increased carbon dioxide levels. So we need to improve the ventilation to remove excess of the carbon dioxide and hence to neutralize everything. And in severe cases, mechanical ventilation may also be necessary by either by CPAPs or BiPAPs or by any other mechanism, or even by ventilators as well. So this was all about the metabolic and respiratory acidosis, and thank you for the patience. And I just want to say all of you that please never forget the hands that loved, cared and raised to build you. So love your parents, they will never come on earth twice. Thank you. Allah Hafiz.